Hey there. It's been a while. After a lot of life changes over the last year, I felt it was time to get back into some game jams. So when Pirate Software announced a game jam in January, I thought that would be a great time. If you don't know Pirate Software at this point, you probably haven't been following the game dev scene on YouTube or Twitch lately. Thor has absolutely blown up over the last few months, and it's been amazing to see. Pirate Software is his game dev studio, and with a small team, they have a game out in early access called Heartbound, which is a non-traditional roleplay game that you should check out if you're a fan of RPGs. The jam itself ran from January 12th to the 26th, which is a timeline I have grown to love way more than the typical 48 hours. Don't take that as me saying 48-hour jams are bad. I just prefer a longer jam nowadays because I don't have to cram for 2 days and sacrifice time with family and friends to take part. So I was all set and ready for the jam, and on January 12th, the theme was announced. And what do we have? It's spreading. As someone who's taken part in a lot of game jams and seen a lot of themes, I liked this one immediately. It's super open to interpretation, and there's so many ways you can take it. Of course, the jam started on a Friday, which is a day that I currently do Feedback Fridays on my livestream. So unfortunately, I was preoccupied playing games made by the community and giving feedback and advice. Then, of course, that night Lady Lark and I had plans already, so it wasn't until Saturday that I really got to start thinking about the jam. Which is when my excitement faded a little bit and everything ground to a halt. The thing about a good game jam theme is it allows for interpretation. The bad thing about a good game jam theme is it allows for way too much interpretation. And I found that I could just not come up with a concept that I liked. In the past, I have jumped headfirst into jams without a great concept for a game, but those do tend to be the ones that I like the least. So this time, I resolved myself that I was going to have a solid idea before I started. It's spreading could be a lot of things, and the first thing that jumped to my mind, as I'm sure a lot of people as well that lived through the last 4 years, was a virus. Or zombies. Or ideas and concepts. And I pretty quickly realized I had no desire to make a game about those subjects. The jam page does say to think outside the box, so maybe spreading butter on toast? Root system spreading underground? Weed spreading in a yard? And I kept going back to a game about kerning letters that I played years ago, where you have to spread letters apart to the correct distance. But unfortunately, nothing stuck out as something that I actually wanted to make. Or in the case of the letter spreading game, which I did like, I didn't think it would be very engaging or memorable. In a jam that brings in a lot of participants, this one having around 8,000 people joined, it gets very easy to become lost in the sea of other games that do something similar to you. So I wanted to make sure I did something that would stand out and people would notice or remember. I legit struggled for 2 days. I would sit down at my computer, write a bunch of concepts, and just hope that one of them would jump out at me as like, I want to do that. At the end of Sunday, I was talking with Lady Lark about some of my ideas. And the one that I was liking the most was flipping the initial negative interpretation of its spreading by spreading joy and happiness in an old folks home where you play as an animal going around, making them feel loved. The, aww, that's so cute, that I got was the confirmation that I needed to put more thought behind that idea. One of the things I really like about the Pirate Software Jam is along with your game, you also need to submit a game design document at the end. Thankfully, the jam provided a link to a sample game design document, so I didn't really have to reinvent the wheel or anything. I just took what was there, deleted their content, and started filling out my own. This is where the game started to evolve a bit, as I marked down my inspirations I wanted to pull from. It's going to be a stealth game, where the new owner has banned pets from the premises, so the residents are sad. You'll be playing as a dog or a cat, where you need to sneak in and give pets and love to the residents while avoiding staff and security cameras. Now personally, I'm not a huge fan of stealth games, but one I did really like was Mark of the Ninja. So I pulled the vision cone mechanic for the enemies and figured that would work perfectly. This would allow the player to clearly know where they can and can't be at any given time. But unlike Mark of the Ninja, I didn't want to make this a platformer, so I decided to go for a top-down game instead. And all I could think about in that style was the dungeon design in The Legend of Zelda or the room design in The Binding of Isaac, which is a heavily distorted top-down view where you can see all four walls of the room at the same time. While writing out the rest of the document, I came up with the term retirement dungeon and fell in love with the name immediately. So what if it's a retirement home for elderly dungeon creatures? Like I said before, I wanted something that would stand out and be memorable. Dungeon Creature Retirement Home was just too good to pass up, so off I went. As usual, I'm using Construct 3 for this project. It's the engine I know the best, and it's gonna do what I need here. So the first things first, I got player movement in. Next up, we need some sad residents that we can make happy. And we're gonna represent that by these red squares that will turn green when they're given what they need. It's gonna end up being a really boring game if you can just walk up to all of them without any obstacles. So next, I started adding staff with vision cones that will walk around. The staff just follow a node system, where each node has an ID number, and then I can set variables on the staff telling them which order to move between the nodes in, and how fast to do it. They can have up to 5 destination points, including the one they start on, and when they reach the end, they just take the same path in reverse. The next obstacle to add was locked doors. I'm giving the player the ability to pick up items, which will also work towards some more complexity in the game. And I'm going to have some residents also not be happy until you bring them whatever they need as well as getting a pet. Like a glass of water, or medicine, or glasses. In the end, those are the only things the residents needed because I ran out of time, but I digress. I really wanted secret passages in the game as well, so I added a screwdriver item that can be used on vents. This opens hidden areas that the player can use to get to residents that first seemed inaccessible. The last mechanic I had on my list was treats to make the player pet happy as well. This way, each level can have 2 objectives. One is to make all the residents happy and escape. This will clear the level. And then you'll get a bonus star if you find all of the treats as well. This way, if you don't feel like looking for everything, you can still finish the level just making residents happy and complete the game. At this point, we're 5 days into the jam, but I've really only been working on it for about 2. And I've already completed all the primary and secondary mechanics in my game design document. So I guess it's time for the really time-consuming part. The art. Because people can be adamant dog or cat people, I decided I wanted the player to be able to choose which one they wanted to play as. Then someone on my stream asked me why I didn't add a ferret as well. If you're not familiar, Thor has some adorable ferrets, and they're a big part of his streaming community. And when you're making a game, you should always know the audience you're making the game for. So, of course, it was an absolute no-brainer to add a ferret as a playable character as well. There's not going to be a mechanical difference between any of the animals, as I felt it would raise the scope a bit too much for this. The jam allows you to use any assets you have the legal commercial rights to use. So, in an effort to work smarter and not harder, I pulled a cat sprite that I made a few years ago for the Stream Avatars extension I use on my stream, and as the creator of the art, I definitely have commercial rights to use it. Luckily, it's cute, and the right size, so I used it as a base to build out both the dog and the ferret. This was a lot of fun, but one thing I did not expect was how difficult it is to make a ferret. I went back and forth for a good while because I just couldn't get it to look quite right. But I think it all paid off because in the end, the ferret definitely is the cutest one. Now, I didn't have a whole lot of time to work on this project during the week, so for the next few days, I just spent my nights after dinner and hanging out with Lady Lark, drawing all the elements I thought I would need. I did curse past me a bit for choosing a distorted top-down perspective. Perspective's tough enough. Perspective and pixel art's kind of annoying. So, I ended up having to redo the doors several times, but in the end, I got it to a place that I found acceptable, and I started on the rest of the room design. I definitely would have liked to have more variety in the end, but to not get lost in the weeds of art, I decided that a stone room and a nicer room with wooden floors would be fine. It ended up taking me from the 17th to the 22nd to get most of the art made, animated, and implemented into the game. And at this point, I ended up doing a huge disservice for future me with how I built up the levels. There's areas like the door frames that the player needs to move under and the hidden walls that need to reveal themselves, which ended up being a nightmare of layers and tile maps and objects to keep track of. I chalked it up to a future me problem, so we'll get back to this later. Just know it's a mess. But I did have a good looking test level built out with most of the art in. The plan is to add more decor and whatnot later, but there was still a lot to do to make sure the game was fun as well as cute. The next day I was streaming and showing off the progress. Construct has this awesome feature that allows you to generate a temporary playable link. So I was able to share that with everybody in chat, allowing them to playtest and find bugs, which we ended up spending all day bug fixing. This is really handy because from the editor I can send the link, watch any issues the player had, then make changes and post a new link right away. It's probably one of my favorite quality of life features in Construct, honestly. We found a ton of issues that are hard as developers to find because we're too close to our games and we play a certain way. One issue we kept running into was that running was kind of just causing a lot of problems. I had it set up that when you would run, the vision cones of the enemies would grow, but it wasn't really making the game any better. It was a neat idea, but the implementation I had wasn't very good, and I didn't really want to rework it. So we turned the function off, and then there was really no reason to have a run button anymore. So I just increased the player's movement speed and removed the ability to run entirely. This also helped simplify the controls. Now the player just had to worry about the 4 directional controls and the action button, which would be used for everything else. Now we've reached the part in the development where we have to do the less fun parts of any game. Menus, level select, and a saving system. One thing I dislike in a lot of stealth games is getting caught and having to redo the whole level again, especially because they usually take a bit while you wait for enemies to pass and such. So I set the game to save its state whenever you make a resident happy, making the residents effectively checkpoints. Meaning that if you get caught, you'll only be sent back to the last one instead of having to play the whole level over again. This kind of quality of life additions are essential in game jams, in my opinion. Same with the fact that the player will be able to select any level without needing to unlock them first. That way, if someone does get stuck, they can just move on and still see the rest of the game. I find this helps keep the experience positive when people are sitting down to play many Game Jam games in a row. It's amazing how fast time flies. The game is in an okay state, and I only have 3 days left. But of course, that pesky life always seems to get in the way. My parents were visiting from out of state the 24th through the 27th, and I'm obviously going to be spending a lot of time with them. So I got work done late at night while I could after everyone went to bed, but progress was definitely slow. I tried to focus on level design, which was a terrible process because I didn't do myself any favors in how I set all of this up. It looks good, but it took forever. And after 2 nights, I only had 3 levels put together. At this point, of course, I was stressing out quite a bit. And of course, Friday's the last day of the jam for me, with it ending at 6 p.m. my time, which means that Thursday night, I had to get everything finished. It's been a good while since I've done an all-night grind to finish a game jam game, but sometimes you just have to do what you gotta do. So after dinner that night, I became future me and sat down to deal with all of the things that I had left. I started with trying to finish the level design because that was going to be the most time-consuming part. My original goal was to have 8 levels in the game, with a slight hope of 10. But seeing as how I finished the 5th level at around midnight, I realized I had to cut my losses and just roll with that. It's not really what I had hoped for, but being realistic about it, having levels not feel so bare would do a lot more for players than having a couple extra. I made a bunch of furniture to fill out the rooms, as well as paintings to disguise a sneaky hidden room that you didn't need any item to access. I made some more residents also, so it wasn't just the same ogre and tiefling over and over again. The Elderly Beholder is one of my most favorite things I've ever made. Then, after far too long of adding sound effects, menu art, and testing, I finally submitted the game around 4 in the morning. And this is the final result. In Retirement Dungeon, you play as one of 3 animals trying to spread joy to the residents of an old folks' home for dungeon creatures. But the evil owner has banned pets from the premises. You must sneak in and around the facility to get pets and bring needed items to the residents. Unlocking doors, traversing secret passages, and collecting treats for yourself. Once the residents are happy, you must escape, all without being caught by the staff or security cameras. Overall, I'm really pleased with this game. As always, there's a lot more that I wish I could have done, but it's a game jam game. That's always going to be the case. I'm writing this script a couple of days after completing the jam, and the game has been really well received so far, which I'm really happy about. It's also brought in my favorite comment that I've ever received on anything. Bad games don't let you pet. Good games let you pet. Great games let you get pet. I think I need to put this on a motivational poster. But just saying that I'm happy with it doesn't help with my design skills for the future, so let's take a second to see what I should do differently next time. First, for me, it's the level design. It's okay, but I realized most of the secret passages are just point to point, and I should have had more dynamic and alternate ways to get around the levels, rather than just going from point A to point B. I just think it would have been more interesting, allowing the player to uncover more of the level and have more agency in how they approach the traversal. The enemy detection cones could have been so much better. In all honesty, they're kinda terrible. I'm just using a sprite and a collision box, which means that they can see through walls and whatnot, and I really wasn't able to add anything that you could hide behind. I thought about it a bit too late in the development to implement it, so sadly, I ended up having to design levels around that, as opposed to the other way, which is making levels that were more interesting. Definitely doing some sort of raycasting vision would have probably been better, but this is where we're at. There are also a few bugs that I didn't catch, which kinda suck, the most egregious being that if you quit out of the level and back to the menu, when you re-enter a new level, it doesn't give you the option to pick a pet. Basically, breaking the game. Luckily, a reload does fix it, and your progress is saved, and the levels aren't locked anyway, so you don't lose too much, but it's definitely annoying and kind of a bummer. That's something I'm going to be fixing after the voting period is over, so it should be good if you try the game out now. There are a few other things that I wish I could have gotten done. Some more art as well. I would have liked a little bit more decor. Everybody has a purple bed. But you do what you can as one person making a game in 2 weeks. So that's the game I made for the Pirate Software Game Jam 14. There's a link in the description if you'd like to try it out for yourself. Leave a comment below about which pet you want to play as. I hope you have fun playing it and enjoyed seeing the process it took to bring it to life. I had a lot of fun getting back into a jam like I used to. If you have any interest in seeing the game making process live, come join me over at twitch.tv/vimlark. You can also see plenty of other jam devlogs, past and future, on this channel, so please subscribe and make sure to hit the bell so you're notified when I post next. I promise it's not going to be as long as it was between this one and the last. I took a bit of a break, so the algorithm is not my friend at the moment. So if you'd like to help out and leave a comment below, that would be amazing. We're also so close to 100,000 subscribers, which is something I never thought was possible. I need to give a huge shout out to my Patreon supporters who've stuck with me through my burnout period, and I can't wait to get more fun content to you all soon. Especially my video producer tier patrons like See The Mess, Nightfall, Motsi, Nazar Salim, Pixelator Gadzi, and Warren Steven Rose. You're all amazing and I can't thank you enough. Thank you all so much for watching. I'll talk with you next time. Have a good one. Later.